So welcome everybody. This will be a talk which is organized by Campus Radio, and today our guest is Mr. Animationalist Fazer from 15MS. He will be talking on mainly how to apply for projects, whether it is an internship or a master thesis or a PhD or any position abroad or in India. So he will be clarifying the few basic things that you should know about how to do a good application. And he will be later in the like in the there will be the talk will be divided in two parts. So in the first half he will be covering the basic stuffs, kind of giving an overview which will be very useful for everybody at every level. And in the later part, after a 5 or 10 minutes break, he will be going on with the details. And there it will be like if you are in a lower batch, say third year or below, so you might leave and you can see the video whenever later you are applying in your higher years. But others are recommended to stay because it will be an in-depth thing. And introducing Animesh, it is my pleasure to host him today. And I don't think I have to introduce enough, like I have to introduce Animesh to anybody in the campus, because already he is popular because of his academic activities that he has done throughout his life in IZER. But even then, I'm pointing out few of his activities while being a student at IZER. He did his second year internship in NCBS in a very good lab under Dr. Mukund Thattai and Dr. Shashi Thuttupalli. And also he was the, I mean, in IZER Kolkata, if there is a person who brought IGM, the IGM concept in IZER Kolkata, it's Animationalist Fazer, and with the help of his friends too. But yeah, it was basically through a result of his efforts. Now, and in the fourth year, so he was more or less involved with IGM and the research going on with IGM. And fortunately, his team won the gold, which is a very good achievement for IZER Kolkata in its first IGM venture. And later he went on to do his master project in MPI Dortmund, the MPI Dortmund or the MPI Molecular Physiology Dortmund, where he worked in the lab of Dr. Gerben Vetter. And now he is set for joining his graduate studies in Cornell University in the Biomedical and Biological Sciences Graduate School program, and wishing him all the best for his future ventures. I'll be handing it over to Animationalist Fazer for continuing with his enriching speak today. So yeah, welcome and continue.
Thank you, Dikta Tanu, for the introduction. So I'll be sharing my screen now. Just a bit of disclaimer that if something goes wrong with the bandwidth and if my voice crackles or the video or the screen is not clearly visible, I'll switch off my camera, web camera, so that the bandwidth is saved. So I now assume that you will be able to see my screen, my presentation. So can somebody confirm? Is it visible? Am I clearly audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you, Shobhit.
Animesh, my voice is a little low.
Okay, yeah. Maybe I am too nervous, but I'll try to speak at the top of my voice. Okay. So yeah, I am Animesh Nilesh Vazir, as Dipta Tanu has introduced me. पहले तो मैं ये आशा करता हूँ कि आप जहाँ से भी जुड़े हो, जहाँ पे भी लोकेटेड हो, आप हेल्दी, सेफ और हैप्पी हो ड्यूरिंग द पैंडेमिक। और आज के डिस्कशन का हमारा टाइटल है स्ट्रैटेजिक अप्रोच टू PhD/Project Applications. वाई द वर्ड स्ट्रैटेजिक? बिकॉज इन माई एक्सपीरियंस, जब कोई भी इंसान एक प्रोसेस वेरी लॉजिकली एंड इन अ वेरी प्लान्ड आउट वे स्टेप वाइज एग्जीक्यूट करता है, तब उस प्रोसेस का आउटकम काफ़ी ज़्यादा पॉजिटिव और सक्सेस काफ़ी ज़्यादा गारंटीड होता है एज कम्पेयर टू द सिचुएशन व्हेन द पर्सन इज़ वेरी कैजुअल इन द अप्रोच, नॉट सो फोकस्ड और वेरी लूज माइंडेड. सो दैट्स व्हाई आई स्ट्रेस ऑन अ वेरी स्ट्रैटेजिक अप्रोच टू अप्लाइंग फॉर एनी एप्लीकेशंस दैट यू आर फिलिंग अप. सो आई विल बी शेयरिंग माय एक्सपीरियंस दैट आई हैव गेन्ड ओवर द 5 इयर्स.
अनिमेश भैया, आई विल बी सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट, Apparently, your video is not visible on Facebook Live. I'll just see what's the problem and I'll be getting back, okay?
Okay, I think it may be due to your screen. Is my video visible on your screen? Because your screen is getting shared on Facebook Live.
Right, I'll check that one second.
But basically, what is important is the slides.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Rishika, can you confirm if my audio is better now?
Is it visible now?
It's so, as in Dipta Tanu's is really loud and clear compared to yours. You
Okay.
should try adjusting your earphones, I guess.
Okay, I'll try unplugging them and. Is it better or is it worse?
Yeah, it's better now. It's loud.
Okay. Then I'll use the laptop microphone.
Yeah, we can continue with the meeting. Yeah.
तो यार हाँ, मैं यही कह रहा था कि एक स्ट्रेटेजिक अप्रोच फॉलो करना काफी इंपॉर्टेंट है जो भी एप्लीकेशन आप कर रहे हो उसके लिए. आपको बताइए कि मैं ड्यूरिंग माय इयर्स एट आईसर आई वाज एसोसिएटेड विद द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बायोलॉजिकल साइंसेस. सो मैं जो भी आपसे शेयर करूंगा आज इट विल बी थ्रू माई एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ अप्लाइंग टू डिफरेंट प्रोजेक्ट्स एंड इंटर्नशिप्स अंडर द परव्यू ऑफ बायोलॉजिकल साइंसेस. डिफरेंट डिसिप्लिन और डिफरेंट सब्जेक्ट्स में थोड़ा थोड़ा चेंज होता है. Applications in different disciplines have different requirements. So I highly encourage you to please contact your relevant seniors from your respective department to get a more first-hand view of your particular department. But in any case, I am काफी confident कि जो भी मैं आज शेयर करूंगा आपसे, it will be highly beneficial and there will be takeaways for everyone. For those who are applying to PhD, of course, but also for those who are seeking to apply for thesis projects, for internships, or even for jobs outside, maybe in the industry or I don't know where you're applying to. और कुछ डिस्क्लेमर्स, आई विल बी टॉकिंग इन अ मिक्स ऑफ हिंदी एंड इंग्लिश. इंग्लिश इट्स माई पर्सनल चॉइस एंड नथिंग इज टू बी ब्लेम्ड ऑन द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स ऑफ द कैंपस रेडियो विथ द लैंग्वेज ऑफ माई चॉइस. आई वॉन्ट टू कीप दिस डिस्कशन वेरी कैजुअल, दैट्स वाई आई हैव चोजन इंग्लिश. इट्स जस्ट लाइक अ फ्रेंडली डिस्कशन बिटवीन अ सीनियर एंड अ जूनियर एंड आई वॉन्टेड टू बी इट अ डिस्कशन इन द एंड. सो दैट्स वाई आई हैड रिक्वेस्टेड दीप्त तनु टू प्लीज लेट इन 16 MS पीपल एज वेल. So that one-to-one interaction can happen. Anyway, so let's continue. In the American system of PhD, when a student applies for any PhD position, he and when he or she gets accepted at the university, he is basically enrolled within the university. And whatever the student does during the period of the PhD is under the umbrella of the university. So of course, the student has to do research in the chosen lab of his or her interest. But apart from that, in the first year, the student has to do a lot of lab rotations, 3 to 4 lab rotations. So what are lab rotations? 3 से 4 महीने का short project होता है, 3 या 4 अलग-अलग labs में. You just go into the lab and see if the research in that lab is comfortable for you. Are you comfortable with the people in the lab? Are you is the prof is the professor suitable for you? His mentorship style is suitable for you or not? Then you have to do certain courses in your first year, very rigorous courses. You have to study for the courses, clear their exams. You also have to teach. Now, teaching responsibility might either be compulsory or optional. Compulsory, अगर आपका फंडिंग जो आपको मिल रहा है अमेरिकन यूनिवर्सिटी से वो अगर आपके टीचिंग रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी के ऊपर डिपेंड करता है तो टीचिंग रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी कंपल्सरी होगी. लेकिन अगर आपका फंडिंग आपकी रिसर्च लैब से आ रहा है, योर प्रोफेसर इज पेइंग यू फॉर योर रिसर्च, देन टीचिंग इज जस्ट फॉर एक्सपीरियंस एंड इज इन मोस्ट केसेस ओनली फॉर 1 or 2 semesters. इसके अलावा जो भी आप लैब ज्वाइन कर रहे हो, योर प्रोफेसर विल हाईली एनकरेज यू टू राइट ग्रांट्स एंड सिक्योर योर ओन फॉर डूइंग योर एक्सपेरिमेंट्स. सो इतना सारा आपको एक्सपीरियंस मिलेगा थ्रू एन अमेरिकन यूनिवर्सिटी. ऑब्वियसली अगर इतना ये सब करना है आपको तो टाइम तो लगेगा. तो एवरेज 5 to 6 years टाइम है फॉर एन अमेरिकन PhD एज अपोज टू अ यूरोपियन PhD सिस्टम इन विच अ स्टूडेंट डायरेक्टली अप्लाइज टू द प्रोफेसर और द रिसर्च लैब दैट ही इज इंटरेस्टेड इन. नाउ अगर वो स्टूडेंट चाहे और अगर उस देश की लैंग्वेज उससे कंपैटिबल है उस स्टूडेंट के लैंग्वेज से, देन ही कैन ऑल्सो टीच, ही कैन ऑल्सो टेक कोर्सेस एंड सो ऑन. बट एनीथिंग दैट द स्टूडेंट डज ड्यूरिंग हिज स्पैन ऑफ PhD इज थ्रू हिज प्रोफेसर, इज थ्रू हिज लैब. सो द स्टूडेंट इज ऑल्सो कनेक्टेड टू द यूनिवर्सिटी इन यूरोप बट इट इज ओनली थ्रू द लैब और ओनली थ्रू द प्रोफेसर. सो द प्रोफेसर ऑफ योर रिसर्च लैब इज योर मेन बॉस एंड योर मेजर रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी इज फोकस्ड ऑन रिसर्च इन द लैब. ऑब्वियसली ये रिसर्च इंटेंसिव काइंड ऑफ स्टाइल है. सो इसमें टाइम थोड़ा कम लगता है, 3 टू 4 years mein European system mein PhD ho jati hai, according to what I have heard. So where to start? मैं तो आपसे यही कहूंगा सबसे पहले कि आप आपके पर्सनल प्रेफरेंसेस एक पेपर पे लिखो एंड ट्राई टू आस्क योरसेल्फ सम क्वेश्चंस एंड ट्राई टू आंसर देम बाय योरसेल्फ. फर्स्ट, क्या आपको कोर्सेस करने हैं आफ्टर 5 इयर्स ऑफ अंडर ग्रेजुएट एजुकेशन, जहां आपने बहुत सारे कोर्सेस कर रखे. डू यू स्टिल वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर डूइंग मोर कोर्सेस एंड गेन मोर एक्सपीरियंस, गेन मोर नॉलेज थ्रू रीडिंग मटेरियल, थेरोटिकल वर्क एंड सो ऑन. उसके बाद क्या आपको लैब रोटेशन करनी है? आपका जो रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट है क्या वो ऑलरेडी पिन पॉइंटेड है? डू यू ऑलरेडी नो व्हाट काइंड ऑफ वर्क यू वांट टू डू, और इट इज स्टिल अ बिट हेजी? इफ इट इज हेजी देन लैब रोटेशंस माइट हेल्प अ लॉट. क्या आपको टीचिंग करने में इंटरेस्ट आता है, और डू यू थिंक अबाउट टीचिंग एज अ मोर ऑफ अ बर्डन ड्यूरिंग योर रिसर्च टाइम? इन विच काइंड ऑफ अ सिस्टम डू यू वॉन्ट टू स्पेंड योर पीएचडी इन, और डू यू वॉन्ट टू डू योर पीएचडी इन अ यूनिवर्सिटी सिस्टम और इन एन इंस्टीट्यूट सिस्टम? यूनिवर्सिटी और इंस्टीट्यूट सिस्टम और एनवायरमेंट्स काफी अलग होती है. जैसे मैंने मेरा थीसिस मैक्स प्लैंक इंस्टीट्यूट में किया था, वो ऐसे इंस्टीट्यूट्स सोली रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट्स होते हैं. वहाँ पे 10 से 15 लैब, 20 लैब्स होती है, जो कि बायोलॉजी के अंडर ही, आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट बायोलॉजी, एक ही सब्जेक्ट के अंडर ही सर्टन फोकस्ड एरियाज पे काम करती है. वेर एज इन एन यूनिवर्सिटी देर आर 10,000-20,000 पीपल एनरोल्ड इन एन यूनिवर्सिटी. देर आर वेरियस डिपार्टमेंट्स अलॉन्ग विद साइंस. यू विल हैव इकोनॉमिक्स डिपार्टमेंट, यू हैव फिलोसॉफी डिपार्टमेंट, यू विल हैव लैंग्वेजेस डिपार्टमेंट. सो यू विल गेट टू इंटरेक्ट विद अ lot of variety of people from different disciplines, and you can also take diverse courses if you wish to. For example, maybe in third year of your PhD you wish that you want to learn Spanish. You can take a Spanish course in the language department of a university setting, which is not possible in an institute setting. So think which kind of a setting do you want to go into. Then location. Now people might not think of this factor, but jab main finally mera sare acceptance aa gaye the, then I think it boiled down mostly to locations. What kind of a location do you want to live in during your PhD? Do you want it to be a rural kind of a setting, a semi-urban kind of a setting, or a very large kind of a city like New York or London or maybe Mumbai, I don't know. So what are your location preferences? Uske baad, what kind of a future are you envisioning for yourself? Do you want to continue in academia? Do you want to move to industry? Do you want to go to science communication? Or do you just want to do PhD for the fun and do something entirely different afterwards? What's your future like for you? What are your family preferences? Aapke maa pita ji kya kahe? Some families might say ki don't go to US, it's far away, time difference bhi jyada hai, ghar jyada aa nahi paoge, Europe is close by, or maybe do it in India. So take into account what are your family preferences, your family pressures.
Anuj bhai, I'm sorry to interrupt once again. I think your presentation is not getting updated on Facebook Live. I'll just check with the problem. I don't know why there is a problem.
In the Zoom meet?
I think it is okay. I'll just check. Okay, I'll just get back to you. Okay.
Okay, then I'll wait here.
You can continue, I guess.
Okay. So yeah, I was talking about what kind of family pressures you have. That is also a very deciding factor in personal preferences. Or bhi kuch responsibilities ya factors aapke preferences mein ho sakte. So also take into account those. Then where to start? So what I did is that I first sort of introspected that what kind of subjects or what kind of topics am I interested within biology. So maine एक इंटरेस्ट मैप बनाया मेरे लिए. आई कैन शो यू माय इंटरेस्ट मैप. सो आई न्यू कि मुझे बायोलॉजी के अंडर एपिजेनेटिक्स नाम का सब्जेक्ट काफी पसंद है. नाउ आई स्टार्टेड थिंकिंग कि ओके, आई कैन एंजॉय स्टडिंग द रोल और इम्प्लीकेशंस ऑफ एपिजेनेटिक्स इन इट्स कनेक्शन टू सेल साइकिल और इट्स कनेक्शन टू डेवलपमेंट, इट्स कनेक्शन टू लर्निंग एंड मेमोरी, इट्स कनेक्शन टू मेटाबॉलिज्म एंड सो ऑन. सो एपिजेनेटिक्स ये मेरा ब्रॉड कंसेप्ट है, और उसके अंडर सो एंड सो टॉपिक्स या क्वेश्चंस स्टडी करने में मुझे पीएचडी में मजा आ सकता है. सो एज यू कैन सी, दिस इज अ वेरी ब्रॉड स्केल ऑफ इंटरेस्ट मैप. किसी का हो सकता है कि भले उसको इतना ब्रॉड इंटरेस्ट मैप उसका ना हो, ऐसा हो सकता है कि उसका एक शॉर्ट इंटरेस्ट क्वेश्चन हो विच इज वेरी नैरो एंड विच इज वेरी फोकस्ड, कि मे बी ही और शी लाइक्स एपिजेनेटिक्स बट इट हिज इंटरेस्ट और हर इंटरेस्ट आर नॉट एज ब्रॉड एज माइंड. ही और शी माइट थिंक कि ओके, एपिजेनेटिक्स के अंडर
I'm interested in studying what is the role of, say, some protein X. So what I think is that if your interest map or your interest is kafi broad, jaise mera tha, mera ek kafi jyada bada interest map tha, then maybe a US kind of a system might be better for you. As opposed to, agar aapka interest kafi jyada focused hai, you are focused on 2, 3, 5 questions within a given topic, then shayad ho sakta hai ki Europe mein aap focused options search karo ki kaun se lab specifically in topics pe kaam karti hai. Aur ek aise mujhe lagta hai ki US setting would be, I think, more beneficial for people who want to continue in academia, want a more sort of a rigorous experience during your PhD, during their PhD with courses, rotations, teaching and all. और जिसको टाइम से फर्क नहीं पड़ता कि मुझे 5 साल लगे, 6 साल लगे या 7 साल लगे या 4 साल लगे, मुझे अगर एकेडमिया में ही मेरा टाइम, मेरा लाइफ मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम स्पेंड करना है, देन आई एम नॉट कंसर्न्ड विद हाउ मच इट टेक्स फॉर माय पीएचडी. सो आई थिंक दीस काइंड ऑफ पीपल माइट बी मोर सुटेड फॉर अ यूएस बेस्ड पीएचडी. दैट्स माय ओपिनियन. नाउ सम पीपल माइट डिफर ऑन समथिंग. एंड यूरोप काइंड ऑफ पीपल माइट बी कि अगर मुझे पीएचडी के बाद जॉब में जाना है, किसी और में जाना है, तो यूरोप काइंड ऑफ अ सिस्टम माइट बी मोर सुटेबल इन माय ओपिनियन. सो एक बार आपने इंटरेस्ट ले डाउन कर लिया कि ओके, मुझे एपिजेनेटिक्स या किसी एक्स सब्जेक्ट के वाई सब टॉपिक में इंटरेस्ट है, सो व्हाट यू शुड डू, आई थिंक यू शुड डू अ फील्ड सर्वे. बहुत सारे अलग अलग वेबसाइट्स अवेलेबल है इंटरनेट पे, पबमेड, गूगल स्कॉलर, साइहब एटसेट्रा. यू कैन सर्च एनी टॉपिक दैट यू वॉन्ट एंड यू विल गेट एंटायर लिटरेचर सर्वे, एंटायर स्टैक ऑफ रिसर्च मटेरियल ऑन इट टू रीड. सो व्हाट आई यूजुअली डिड इज दैट, जब मेरे को ऐसा पता चला कि मुझे इस टॉपिक में इंटरेस्ट हो सकता है, I usually went back and revised my undergraduate courses. Usme mujhe interest kyun generate hua? Obviously, I read it somewhere. I did some undergraduate course at ICER Kolkata. So go back and try to brush up your knowledge gained through that course. Read slides, revise class notes, study reference textbooks if you have PDF or hard copies. And now once you revise your textbook material, uske baad go and read review articles. So okay, epigenetics mein mujhe protein X ke upar interest aa raha hai. So what I'll do is I'll Google protein X epigenetics review articles. So Google mere ko bahut sare review articles dega. So what I'll do is I'll pick 3 or 4 good review articles and I'll read 2 to 3 of them. I'll try to read as much as review articles as I can. Review articles se kya hota hai, wo topic ke bare mein aapka jo knowledge hai wo kafi jyada deepen ho jata hai. You get substantial knowledge in that particular topic that you're now slightly interested in. After reading review articles, while reading review articles, aapko dikhega ki review articles mein रिसर्च आर्टिकल्स, रिसर्च पेपर्स किसी ने साइट किए होंगे. सो गो एंड रीड दोज रिसर्च पेपर्स. रिसर्च पेपर्स डायरेक्टली प्रेजेंट द डेटा एंड द डिटेल्स ऑफ द एक्सपेरिमेंट्स एंड द लैब्स दैट कंडक्टेड दोज एक्सपेरिमेंट्स. सो देन रीड रिसर्च आर्टिकल्स एंड देन फर्दर अटेंड वर्चुअल वर्कशॉप्स, सिंपोजियम्स, कॉन्फ्रेंसेस एक्सेट्रा. आजकल तो जूम पे काफी ज्यादा हो रहा है. आप सर्च करो कि आपके टॉपिक में, आपके इंटरेस्ट में क्या क्या हो रहा है जूम पे. मोस्ट ऑफ देम आर फ्री टू अटेंड. सो ट्राई डूइंग दैट इफ यू हैव टाइम. सो इससे क्या होगा कि आपका जो फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट है उसका आप पूरा सर्वे करोगे. यू विल हैव अ गुड नॉलेज कि कहाँ पे कहाँ तक रिसर्च पहुंचा है, व्हाट आर द न्यू एवेन्यूज इन दिस फील्ड एंड सो ऑन. सम गुड टिप्स दैट आई विल बी गिविंग यू, स्विच ऑन ईमेल नोटिफिकेशंस फ्रॉम गुड जर्नल्स. से इफ यू लाइक नेचर, साइंस, ई लाइफ, वॉट एवर जर्नल्स दैट आर ऑफ योर इंटरेस्ट. केमिस्ट्री में जैक्स होगा, फिजिक्स में और कुछ होगा. सो स्विच ऑन ईमेल नोटिफिकेशंस फ्रॉम द जर्नल. सो जब भी कोई इंटरेस्टिंग आर्टिकल पब्लिश होगा, यू कैन ऑल्सो स्विच ऑन ईमेल नोटिफिकेशंस विद सर्टन कीवर्ड्स. सो जब भी वो कीवर्ड वाला कोई आर्टिकल पब्लिश होगा, यू विल गेट ईमेल नोटिफिकेशंस. फॉलो पीपल ऑन गूगल स्कॉलर. गूगल स्कॉलर पे अलग अलग रिसर्चर्स के प्रोफाइल होते हैं, अलग अलग लैब्स के. यू कैन फॉलो पीपल एंड वेन एवर दैट लैब, दैट प्रोफेसर पब्लिशेस अ पेपर और वेन एवर अ प्रीवियस पेपर फ्रॉम दैट लैब इज साइटेड बाय अ न्यू पेपर, यू विल गेट एन ईमेल. सो उससे क्या होगा कि आप अपडेटेड रहोगे व्हाट्स हैपनिंग इन योर फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. नाउ वेन एवर यू आर बोर्ड, मे बी यू जस्ट गो एंड सर्फ ऑन फेसबुक, यूट्यूब, इवन आई डू. Try also going on some journal websites and try surfing them, say Nature, Science, eLife, JAX, whatever your favorite websites are, and see what new articles are coming up in those. That's, I think, a good way to also entertain yourself as well as keep updated. And very important suggestion, get on academic Twitter. Agar Twitter account nahi hai, Twitter account banao, usse kafi acha networking hota. So yeah, talking about networking, it is very important to know कि आपके फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट में कौन सी लैब, कौन सा प्रोफेसर क्या काम कर रहा है, उसके कौन कोलैबोरेटर्स है, हाउ आर द कनेक्शंस स्प्रेड आउट लाइक. फर्स्ट, जब आप पेपर पढ़ रहे हो, रिव्यू पढ़ रहे हो, नोट डाउन हु आर द ऑथर्स. कोई साइटेशन मिला, उसके ऑथर्स कौन है, जो साइटेड पेपर है उनके ऑथर्स कौन है, वो नोट डाउन करो. व्हेनेवर यू आर अटेंडिंग कॉन्फ्रेंसेस, सी की हु आर द बिग नेम्स इन द कॉन्फ्रेंसेस, हु आर द फ्रीक्वेंट अटेंडीज इन द कॉन्फ्रेंसेस, पोस्टर प्रेजेंट करने किस लैब से स्टूडेंट्स आ रहे हैं, टॉक्स कौन कौन से प्रोफेसर ज्यादा दे रहे हैं कॉन्फ्रेंसेस में, ये नोट डाउन करो. ऑब्वियसली टॉक टू योर थीसिस मेंटर, योर इंटर्नशिप प्रोफेसर, योर सीनियर्स इन रिलेवेंट टॉपिक, और उनसे गाइडेंस लो कि कौन प्रोफेसर अच्छा पेपर पब्लिश कर रहा है, अच्छा काम कौन से लैब में से आजकल आ रहा है. कीप टॉकिंग टू डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ पीपल टू स्प्रेड योर नेटवर्क. एंड अगेन ज्वाइन एकेडमिक ट्विटर. यू विल फॉलो वन बिग प्रोफ इन योर फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. दैट बिग प्रोफ विल बी फॉलोइंग 100 डिफरेंट लैब्स इन हीज फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट. सो ऐसे आपका नेटवर्क बढ़ता जाएगा ऑन ट्विटर. एंड मेनी ऑफ द प्रोफ्स कीप गिविंग आउट लैब वेकेंसीज, न्यू पेपर अनाउंसमेंट्स एंड मेनी अदर इन्फॉर्मेशन ऑन ट्विटर. सो प्रोफेसर्स मोस्टली डू नॉट यूज फेसबुक एंड अदर सोशल मीडिया, दे मोस्टली यूज ट्विटर. सो आई थिंक ट्विटर इज अ ट्विटर प्रोफेसर्स ऑल्सो यूज एज वेल एज देयर स्टूडेंट्स पोस्ट जॉब्स दे ऑल्सो यूज. सो इट्स अ गुड वे टू कनेक्ट इन द एकेडमिया. जब आप ये सब करोगे तब आपके पास आपके हाथ में 10 से 12 नामों की PIs की लैब्स की एक लिस्ट होगी, which I call a tentative list. The list of PIs who you think, whose research interests you. Then see कि उन professors के साथ आपका interest match हो रहा है क्या? Is your research really resounding with them? Also, there might be a prof who is a big name, but is now publishing recent publications. ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए कि वो lab काफी great है, लेकिन 10 साल पहले तक अच्छा पेपर पब्लिश कर रही थी, अभी जस्ट रिव्यू दे रही है, लेकिन अच्छा रिसर्च मटेरियल अभी आ नहीं रहा, स्टैग्नेशन हो गया थोड़ा. ये भी देखो कि रिसेंट पब्लिकेशंस आ रहे कि नहीं आ रहे. उसके बाद देखो कि इज द लैब इंटरनेशनल. एक ही देश के मेंबर्स तो लैब में भरे नहीं है ना. सी इफ इंडियंस हैव ऑलरेडी बीन एल्यूमनाई और आर करंट ग्रुप मेंबर्स इन द ग्रुप. अगर ऑलरेडी आईसर के एल्यूमनाई उस लैब में ज्वाइंट है, देन योर प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ गेटिंग अ गुड रिप्लाई फ्रॉम द प्रोफेसर इंक्रीजेस ट्रिमेंडसली, because the professor already knows your alma mater institute. Then see if the alumni record is good. Wo lab mein se jo bhi students nikle hai, kya are they publishing good research right now? Have they been able to get secure good academic position, good industry positions right now? How is their alumni record like? And also take your thesis mentor's opinion on that lab and on that professor. Of course, hamare jo professors hote hain, unke bhi kafi jyada spread out networks hote hain. They know many people one to one. So seek their opinion as well. Now, once you have a tentative list of, say, 10 to 12 people, the most important thing, no matter which system you're applying to, US or Europe, the most important thing you should do is write emails, first emails. And this 5 to 6 slides that I'll be talking about now will be beneficial for everyone, for those who are seeking thesis projects, for those who are seeking internships, for those who want to apply to jobs, as well as PhD applicants. Okay, so this is a template of the email that I had written to my thesis mentor during my fourth year to seek my thesis project. So I'll just run you through what kind of an email I had written. It's not like an ideal email. It is just a sort of an example ki aisa email aap likh sakte. Obviously other seniors will give you other opinions. Also take those into consideration. This is by no means the only rule that you'll get success by. So yeah, first of all, write a very clear title. Pehle main kya karta tha ki sirf seeking guidance ya applying for your guidance, ऐसे एकदम काफी ambiguous title लिखता था. But now I realize that writing a clear title actually helps. Write a very clear title, application for MS thesis project, or application for a graduate studentship, application for internship project, whatever it may be. Then comes the first paragraph. First of all, for salutation, in the West, if you are applying in Europe, or say in Japan, or Japan is in the East, but anyway, in US or anywhere in Canada, address the professor as dear, doctor and the last name. Because if you write sir or madam, then the professor thinks ki aapne kafi generic email likha hai aur yahi email aapne 100 logon ko bheja hoga. Lekin agar aap dear, doctor, last name likhte ho, to kafi achha impact, first impact padta hai. I was a bit conservative in my fourth year, so I wrote dear sir. I used to write dear sir and ma'am. So yeah, write dear, doctor and last name. In the first paragraph, introduce yourself. Who are you? Okay, so I'm Animish Nilesh Vase, a fourth year undergrad student at ISER Kolkata. Now introduce your alma mater, introduce your institute. What is ISER Kolkata famous for? Why is ISER Kolkata a good institute in India? Spend 1 to 2 lines on it. Describe your program. I think aap bhi pad sakte ho while I'm talking. Describe your BSMS program or whatever program you are enrolled in. And end the first paragraph by writing a clear line. Why are you writing this email? So I'd written the present email is to inquire about an opportunity for working and learning at your lab as a potential MS thesis student. So usually in my second paragraph, I write mostly about the topic that I'm applying to. Why is this topic of interest to me? व्हाई आई एम इंटरेस्टेड इन दिस, इस टॉपिक में मेरा खुद का इंटरेस्ट बढ़ाने के लिए मैंने क्या क्या एफर्ट्स लिए हैं, दिस इज समथिंग आई राइट अबाउट. एंड देन आई एंड माई सेकेंड पैराग्राफ सेइंग दैट ओके फॉर मोर डिटेल्स आई हैव ऑल्सो अटैच्ड माई सीवी एंड लेटर ऑफ मोटिवेशन. आई विल कम बैक टू व्हाट इज सीवी एंड लेटर ऑफ मोटिवेशन अगेन. एंड देन इन द थर्ड पैराग्राफ आई डिस्कस लॉजिस्टिक्स कि मुझे आपके लैब में कब से कब आना है, इफ इट इज अ थीसिस व्हेन विल माई थीसिस प्रोजेक्ट स्टार्ट इन योर लैब एंड व्हेन इट इज सपोज टू एंड, इफ इट इज इंटर्नशिप लाइकवाइज. सो डू यू हैव फंडिंग, विल यू नीड फंडिंग, एंड अगेन फोकस इन द लास्ट लाइन ऑफ द थर्ड पैराग्राफ कि आई एम रियली इंटरेस्टेड इन योर वर्क, आई विल बी वेरी हैप्पी इफ आई गेन अ पॉजिटिव रिप्लाई फ्रॉम यू थैंकिंग यू यू आर सिंसियरली सो एंड सो. सो दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ अ टेम्पलेट आई फॉलो फॉर माई ईमेल्स. यू कैन फॉलो एनी अदर टेम्पलेट बट मेक श्योर दैट योर ईमेल इज कंसाइज. People do not have much time to spend on your email. They usually scroll through your email like in just 1 or 1.5 minutes. So make your CV and letter of motivation more detailed. Now I'll come to that. CV. I usually attach a CV. So this is the format of my CV. I usually include a CV which has some amount of colors. It is not black and white. Also, it is not like a rainbow color. So having limited amount of colors will naturally catch the attention of the listener or the reader. And I also include a CV template in which there is my photo and some detailed, some personal information like my birth date, my name and so on. So I have hidden some personal information in my CV, but usually I write academic profile first in which I mention what I am currently doing, my 12th marks, my current GPA. Then comes research interest. I give headings of different topics and 1 to 2 line description of what exactly I'm interested in that broad topic. Then comes research experience, where I list my internship and my previous experience. Then relevant skills, courses, and whatever you have done to sort of make your CV up. Then any publications if you have, any academic achievements, any workshops, training schools you have attended, some extracurriculars like hobbies you can mention, and names of 2 referees whom the professor that you are applying to can get back to and ask how you are as a student. So I usually list 2 referees. That is a short and sweet but attractive format that I follow for my CV. You can follow some other format. So letter of motivation. In my experience, this is the most important document to get positive replies from professors. Mera positive response ka jo rate hai wo almost aisa hai ki agar main 7 emails bhejta hu to usme se mujhe 3 or 4 positive replies, encouraging replies aate hain. That's how my rate of positive replies is, and I think it is solely because of this letter of motivation. What is letter of motivation? I said ki email jo tumhara hai wo to ekdam short and sweet likho so the professor can scroll through it in just like 2 minutes. So CV to mera information batata hai. So letter of motivation is something that I make to make my CV more detailed and specific for that lab. It is like a 2-page document that I draft. Pehle to document ke upper part mein I mention my details, who am I, what is my affiliation, my relevant courses and lab skills. And then in the first paragraph I write in detail why I feel enthusiastic about this particular field of research or this particular topic. What have I done to increase my knowledge base in this topic. Then in the second paragraph I mention what papers of the professor I have read. I usually mention 3 to 4 or 5 questions that came to me on reading his 1 or 2 papers, or maybe some ideas that I might have upon reading those papers to how to take that project forward and so on. And finally, in the third paragraph, I mention about the logistics of the project. When do I want to visit your laboratory for the project? What do I have funding? Will I need funding? Why am I specifically applying to that lab? Why am I specifically applying to that university and so on? So this letter of motivation se kya hota hai ki prof ko ye lagta hai ki haan bhai, ye bande ne, ye bandi ne, ye student ne kafi achha homework kiya hai before applying to me. He's not sending the same email to 100 labs all over the world. So that increases his confidence level in you a lot. And I think that this is the crux of getting positive replies for any application that you're applying to. Be specific to that application. Jo read kar raha hai application, usko aisa nahi lagna chahiye ki bhai isin ye bande ne aisi assignment kar tara 10 jagah yahi chhap diya hoga. So yeah, that's about the letter of motivation. Just to confirm once ki awaaz sahi se aa rahi hai, kuch technical difficulties to nahi hui ab tak. Deepthi Tanu?
No, it's fine. It's fine. Continue.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, so responses. What kind of responses will you get? Ek to ho sakta hai koi reply na aaye. It's pretty obvious. Professors are very busy. Then you should send reminder after 1 week. Fir bhi agar reply nahi aaya, और अगर आप उस लैब में अप्लाई के लिए बहुत ज्यादा एंथुजियास्टिक हो और एक वीक के बाद भी रिप्लाई नहीं आया डिस्पाइट आफ्टर अ रिमाइंडर, देन सेंड वन मोर रिमाइंडर नाउ फ्रॉम अनदर मेल. बिकॉज कभी कभी क्या होता है, द मेल यू आर यूजिंग फॉर द फर्स्ट ईमेल और द सेकंड ईमेल योर रिमाइंडर ईमेल गेट्स स्पैम फिल्टर्ड इन दैट प्रोफेसर्स इनबॉक्स. सो राइट द सेकंड रिमाइंडर ईमेल फ्रॉम सम अनदर ईमेल आईडी. अगर फिर भी रिप्लाई नहीं आया ठीक है, फिर मूव ऑन करो, उसको ज्यादा स्पैम मत करो. इफ देयर इज अ नेगेटिव रिप्लाई देयर इज नथिंग यू कैन डू मच, जस्ट थैंक द प्रोफेसर अगेन फॉर टेकिंग नोट ऑफ योर एप्लीकेशन एंड जस्ट मूव ऑन. नाउ इफ देयर इज पॉजिटिव एनकरेजमेंट फ्रॉम द प्रोफेसर, नाउ इन टर्म्स ऑफ पीएचडी एप्लीकेशंस प्रोफेसर ऐसे कह सकता है कि ठीक है यू आर अ वेरी गुड कैंडिडेट, आई लाइक योर सीवी, आई एम इम्प्रेस्ड बाय योर लेटर ऑफ मोटिवेशन, डू अप्लाई टू अवर सो एंड सो पीएचडी प्रोग्राम ऑफ सो एंड सो यूनिवर्सिटी, आई विल कंसिडर योर एप्लीकेशन. आप क्या कर सकते हो कि ओके इट इज अ पॉजिटिव एनकरेजमेंट बट इट इज नॉट लाइक अ वेरी पॉजिटिव एनकरेजमेंट. वॉट यू कैन डू इज यू कैन ट्राई टू एंगेज द मोर, आस्क इफ द प्रोफेसर विल बी हैप्पी टू रिव्यू यूर एसओपीज एंड अदर एप्लीकेशन डॉक्यूमेंट्स लेटर एंड आफ्टर यू आर डन विथ अप्लाइंग टू द यूनिवर्सिटी. जो भी प्रोफेसर ने बोला है कि इस यूनिवर्सिटी में अप्लाई करो, रिमाइंड द प्रोफेसर कि ओके आई हैड रिटर्न टू यू सीकिंग फॉर अ पीएचडी पोजिशन, नाउ आई हैव अप्लाइड, प्लीज कंसिडर माई एप्लीकेशन, थैंक यू. और अगर आपको स्काइप के लिए प्रोफेसर बोल रहे हैं कि ओके आई एम वेरी इंप्रेस्ड बाय योर एप्लीकेशन, लेट्स डू अ स्काइप कॉल, तब तो भाई प्रोफेसर इज वेरी इंप्रेस्ड विद योर एप्लीकेशन एंड यू शुड बी रियली वेरी हैप्पी फॉर द एफर्ट यू हैव पुट इन इनटू योर एप्लीकेशन. सो या कॉन्ग्रेट्स. सो स्काइप इंटरेक्शन में क्या होता है, स्काइप इंटरेक्शन इज वेरी कैजुअल, द प्रोफेसर इज ऑलरेडी इंप्रेस्ड बाय योर एप्लीकेशन. वरना तो वो प्रोफेसर जो हाफ अ वर्ल्ड अक्रॉस बैठा है या इसी कंट्री में किसी दूसरे सिटी में बैठा है is not so foolish to spend like say half an hour or one hour of his very important time on any student half a world across. So if he's asking for Skype interaction with you, he's already impressed. This Skype interaction will be very casual, don't worry. आपको आपकी तरफ से क्या क्या explain करना है Skype interaction में, first personal background कि आप कहाँ से आ रहे हो, आपका education अब तक क्या है, next your research experiences, what internships you have done, what skills you have gained, next research interest, what topics you are interested in, how do you want to take those topics forward during a PhD? Then personal goals. Why do you want to do a PhD? What do you want to do with your future and so on? ये सब अगर आपको professor पूछेगा तो अच्छा ही है. लेकिन professor अगर नहीं भी पूछा, professor कुछ बताना पूछना भूल भी गया, try that you cover these topics in whatever you say to the professor. और professor should ensure that he explains these stuffs. क्या क्या उसके lab में क्या क्या projects फिलहाल चल रहे हैं, what research projects, what research direction will he be taking in the future, what research direction will the lab be leading into, what is the PhD program structure through which he takes students in his lab, what is the application process, will that university, will that program need GRE, will it need TOEFL, will it need an SOP, how you should apply and so on. You should ask these things to the professor. Agar wo khud bataye acha hi hai, nahi bataye to aap poocho. You should ask the mentoring style. Is the professor more hands-on or more hands-off? Professor बच्चों को micromanage कर रहा है, हर उनके activity में नजर रख के बोल रहा है ये मत करो वो करो, ऐसी उसकी style है या he is more laid off and he gives much freedom to the students? Then ask about funding. कि does the lab has enough funding? Does the lab have enough funding to take you? Is there a vacancy for you? Ask these things if he does not explain by himself or herself. I'm trying to stay gender neutral, but please excuse me if I slip somewhere. So yeah, also ask if he or she will review your application documents, that is jab aap SOP likhoge, ask during Skype if he or she will be happy to review those documents and edit them for you. Second, this Skype interaction is the most crucial step for Europe applications. Agar aapko Europe mein jana hai PhD ke liye, maine aapko pehle hi bola ki Europe mein jana hai to applying to the lab is the first and foremost step. Lekin agar US mein jana hai, then Skype interaction is just the start of the game. So we'll continue and see how it goes. Okay, so after all of this stuff, aapne ek tentative list banai, alag alag professors ko within the tentative list you have sent emails, some have emailed you back for Skype interaction, some have negative replied you, some have just not replied you, some have encouraged you to apply but will not do Skype with you. So iske baad aapko pata chalega ki kaun sa lab really enthusiastic hai aapko lene ke liye. So try to update your tentative list based on the response you have received. Preferably after you do Skype or after you get a positive email from the professor, try to talk with the ex-students or alumni or current students of that lab or of that professor to get a more student's side view. Then final list should be around 10 to 12 PhD programs or universities or institutes. 10 से 12 universities varied, अलग अलग जगह पे वो हो, some US, some Canada, some Europe, ऐसा एक final list बनाओ depending on how you get the response from professors in your tentative list. Ask your thesis mentor to honestly grade your profile. कि आपके thesis mentor को पूछो कि सर या मैडम आप मुझे बताओ what kind of a profile do you think I have? Do you think I have chances of getting into Harvard? Do you think I have chances of getting into Cambridge? Do you think I have chances of getting into a more mid-range university? What do you think my chances are in different scales of universities? उसके बाद आप खुद introspect करो कि how have you been as a student during your time in your undergraduate education? Have you been like a very excellent student throughout your academics? You have like been a consistently good grader, good scorer in your department. Introspect yourself. What is your range exactly? उसके बाद final list should fulfill your academic and research interests and as well as personal expectations. कि location कैसी होनी चाहिए? What do the family say about that place? Courses and जो भी मैंने पहले personal preferences बताए थे, do these final list universities and programs fulfill them? उसके बाद you should have a good mixture of all universities, good range, top range, average range. This good, top, average, these definitions again vary for every candidate. As I said, you need to introspect and honestly talk and ask your thesis mentor ki unko kya lag raha hai, where is your range, and also go with your gut feeling. Kabhi kabhi professor bolega ki bhai tera usme us university mein nahi ho sakta, ya professor might say ki us university mein ho sakta hai, but what does your gut feeling say? Go with your gut feeling, it really guides you in the correct direction. Now what is the suggested timeline? First, actually thoda bhi late ho chuka hai, but better late than never. Start field review during June and July. Prepare your tentative list during August and September. Send out the first emails during August and September. Get done with TOEFL in August and September, August or September. Start preparing your SOP in September or late September, early October. Prepare final list by October or November. हाँ, आप जिस प्रोफेसर को आपके रेफरीज बना रहे हो फॉर राइटिंग रिकमेंडेशन लेटर्स, दे शुड गेट द रेफरेंस लेटर सबमिशन लिंक वेरी अर्ली, बिकॉज अगर आप काफी लेट भेजोगे रेफरेंस सबमिशन रिकमेंडेशन सबमिशन लिंक, देन देर माइट बी सम टेक्निकल ग्लिच, और दे माइट सबमिट रॉन्ग रिकमेंडेशन लेटर, दे माइट यूज द रॉन्ग लिंक, दे माइट नॉट राइट अ गुड रिकमेंडेशन लेटर फॉर यू. सो इंटीमेट योर प्रॉफ अर्ली कि मुझे आपका रिकमेंडेशन लेटर लगेगा फॉर अप्लाइंग फॉर पीएचडी पोजिशंस और फॉर जॉब एप्लीकेशंस, व्हाटएवर. स्टार्ट फिलिंग योर एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म्स इन अक्टूबर एंड नवंबर. यूजुअली यूएसए के डेडलाइन काफी स्टैंडर्ड होते हैं. इन बायोलॉजी मोस्ट ऑफ द डेडलाइंस आर ऑन डिसंबर 1st और ऑन डिसंबर 15, सिमिलरली फॉर फिजिक्स, केमिस्ट्री एंड अदर डिसिप्लिन्स. मोस्ट यूएस यूनिवर्सिटीज एडहियर टू अ स्टैंडर्ड डेडलाइन, वेयर एज इन यूरोप इट इज क्वाइट स्पेसिफिक और इट इज क्वाइट डिपेंडेंट ऑन द प्रोग्राम. कि कौन से, हर यूनिवर्सिटी का अलग डेडलाइन होता है. Some universities may have deadline in September end, some may have in early October, some may in November end. किसी किसी का February late तक शुरू होगा. So you have to see what university is in your final list और उसका deadline कब है. But yeah, start filling your application forms early. Okay, so to not saturate you too much in one go, I am planning to give like a 5-minute break so that you can relax from your Zoom fatigue, walk away, just relax yourself, and we'll be back in 5 minutes. So एनालॉग क्लॉक तो नहीं है, डिजिटल क्लॉक तो नहीं है मेरे पास. अभी 8:15 हुआ है, सो आई स्टार्ट व्हेन इट इज 8:20 इन माय क्लॉक, एनालॉग क्लॉक. सो मीनवाइल दीप्ति तनु, व्हाटएवर यू वांट टू कंडक्ट यू कैन कंडक्ट, और वी कैन जस्ट चिट चैट नॉर्मली.
लेट मी आस्क यू 3 क्वेश्चंस व्हिच आई हैव रजिस्टर्ड सो फार, सो आई विल जस्ट गेट बैक टू द क्वेश्चंस. इज इट ओके फॉर यू? नो,
या इट इज ओके फॉर मी, बट इट शुड नॉट बी क्वाइट सैचुरेटिंग फॉर दोज हु आर लिसनिंग. Because आगे भी काफी बचा है that I want to share.
Yeah, please others please stay on the call, and also we would request our audience on Facebook Live to bear with us for a break of 5-10 minutes, after which we'll be going to an in-depth explanation of what Animesh has been speaking so far. So yeah, so I'll go back to the questions. Okay, I'll just take one or two questions now. Okay.
थोड़ा जोर से बोलना. I can't listen because I haven't connected your
feed. Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Is this good now?
Yeah, it is good.
Okay. So, there was a question.
Europe too has grad school programs like US, right? So, would you like to comment on that?
So yeah, I applied to just two European universities. One is EMBL एंड अदर वॉज फ्रांसिस क्रिक. सो उनके जो एप्लीकेशंस थे वो काफी ज्यादा यूएस स्टाइल्ड थे, एज इन उनके एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म काफी डिटेल्ड और काफी रिक्वायरिंग थे. दे डिड नॉट रिक्वायर एसओपी एज सच, बट दे आस्क सम पर्सनल एंड रिसर्च बेस्ड क्वेश्चंस इन देयर एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म इटसेल्फ. बट इन जनरल यूरोप के एप्लीकेशंस काफी ज्यादा नो नॉनसेंस होते हैं. लाइक दे कम टू द पॉइंट, वॉट इज योर रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट, वाई इज दिस योर रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट, वॉट पेपर्स डू यू यूजली रीड. इट इज मोर, एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म्स आर मोर रिसर्च ओरिएंटेड. और यूएस एप्लीकेशंस आर मोर लाइक व्हाट काइंड ऑफ अ पर्सनालिटी डू यू हैव, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ अ बैकग्राउंड डू यू बिलोंग टू, ये सब भी मैटर करता है इन यूएस एप्लीकेशंस. सो दैट इज माय इनसाइट और माय एक्सपीरियंस फॉर अप्लाइंग टू प्रोग्राम्स इन यूरोप दैट आर मोर यूएस स्टाइल. बट अदर प्रोग्राम्स, मोस्ट अदर यूनिवर्सिटीज आर थ्रू मेल टू द प्रोफेसर बेसिस.
So my second,
but yeah, you can always go and search for any specific university. How is the program like? How is the application process like?
Okay, so the second question is, it's more based on either Kolkata PhD program. Okay, so is there any institute fellowship either provide for PhD study? So that was a question asked by somebody who is not an Iserite, I guess. But yeah, do you know about the Isar Kolkata program or the fellowships offered through these programs?
So to the best of my knowledge, the students who are already studying in undergraduate Isar courses, if they wish to transit or wish to transform their undergraduate degree to continue to a PhD degree at the same Isar, then I think they can continue their Inspire fellowship. I have heard or read something similar to that. And if you are applying from outside, then what I have heard is you need to clear the NET JRF and then the government will give you the grant. But I don't think there is ISER specific grant for PhD projects as far as I know. But I'll still suggest, I'm not an expert on that topic, I'll suggest to talk to PhD students at ISER or go to the respective website and search it up. That's what I know.
So moving on to the next question. Somebody wanted your comment on PhD or projects in Canada and asked if it is same as in US, and he wants your comment on that.
Okay, so what limited knowledge I have from talking to seniors is that Canada is more like a hybrid process, Europe jaisa bhi hota, US jaisa bhi hota. So what I have heard is you first need to write an email to a particular professor or to a particular lab. And then if the lab selects you, then he will encourage you to apply through the university portal. But I think just applying to the university portal as it is in US cannot help you alone in Canada. That's what I have heard. But again, to be honest, I'm not an expert on that topic as well. But that's what I have heard to the best of my knowledge. You first need to get a go ahead, a green signal from the professor, and then you will get selected through the university portal.
Moving on to the next question, did you talk to your referees about what they will write about in their reference letters, specifically considering you would want their SOPs not to be generic?
SOPs or recommendation letter?
Yeah, I mean, did you talk to the, like, I think the person is asking if you have spoken to the referees about what they will prefer being written in their, I mean, the reference letters.
So I have already covered that topic in my slides ahead. I guess that question will be answered as we go ahead. But if still the question is persistent at the end of the talk, he or she can re-ask it in a better framed way and I can re-answer them, because I have already included that in the slides ahead.
Yeah, so the next question is, what do you mean by reviewing SOPs? So you said reviewing SOPs while you were talking on SOPs, right? So he wanted to ask what you meant by that, reviewing SOPs.
So how about I'll keep this point in my mind, and when I discuss SOPs in my slides next, I'll discuss this question as well. I'll try to answer this question.
I'll be taking the last question of the break so far. So for European project specific programs, how do you know about the work or the lab culture beforehand, especially considering that you are committing for a 5 or 4 year, whatever be the project length, you are committing for that duration and you cannot opt out?
You can opt out, so that's not a problem anyway. You can always opt out. But yeah, that question was also relevant for me when I was applying, because I was quite reluctant to commit my entire 4 year PhD period to one single lab, one single professor, without knowing him enough. So that's why I like the US system personally more, because you get to know the professor, the lab environment through the rotations. But if you are really focused on applying to European universities, then what you can do is you can try to research as much as you can about the professor, about the lab, from different people, from your professors, from seniors, from previous students or current students in the lab. And most of the time, they will share confidential information about the professor, about the lab environment to you on a one-to-one chat in a non-written way. So if you are really looking for applying to a particular professor in Europe, after you have done talking to the professor on Skype, try to bring his or her current students on a Skype meeting later, and then try to discuss your issues or your questions about the professor in an informal way. And I'm quite sure that most students will be quite honest in sharing information about how their professors are.
Okay, thank you. So from anybody in the meeting,
Deepto.
Yeah, you have a question?
No, the thing is, from the meeting, when they're going to ask the question, at the end or right now?
At the end, they will be asking the questions, but I can take two questions from the ones who are in the meeting now. So why not go ahead?
Then they should at least write it in the chat box, so that first two will be chosen and ask the questions. That will be better.
Okay, fine. Yeah, whatever. So you can type in your questions in the chat box. We'll be taking two now.
How about people type questions separately to either Diktatanu or Shovik? Because then it will not distract me, because chat notification pop-up will distract me. Anyway, I mean, it's not a big deal, but still.
Okay, and one more concern is, like, your a part of your presentation towards the bottom and also at the top of your slide is getting cropped out. Yeah, it is getting cropped out, yes, I guess. So I think somebody raised the concern in the group, and that's why I was saying. So can you zoom in or out or do something so that the full region is visible?
Okay, so what I'll ask is, the people in the meeting, is the screen visible in a good way to them?
It is cropped. Like it is cropped.
Oh,
like on my screen,
but
it is cropped. At
okay,
least.
Okay.
Shovik, is it
not
cropped?
Not that much. It is only a little bit. I guess the font part is only a little bit. Not.
Yeah, the last line is going out of the screen.
Actually, okay. The upper part is little bit cropped. Not that much.
Yes. Same for me. Also.
I'm afraid that I can't change much here, because if I.
Yeah, it is already present in the presented view. You can change, I think.
Sorry,
it
what?
Okay, I guess.
Okay, wait. Is it better now?
No, I guess. It's the same thing.
Then I'll have to stop sharing and try again.
No, don't do that. It's fine, I guess. I mean, if too many information is not
it's
getting
fine,
out,
it's
fine.
Let's go ahead.
I think you can continue. You can start off now, I guess. It's already 5 minutes. So.
Okay, yeah. So, yeah, we'll continue. So, yeah. Talking about English and English related exams that you need to write before applying or during your applications for PhD. Ye to ek aap jaan lo ki science mein ideas jyada matter karte hai as compared to languages. As long as you are comfortably able to convey what your idea is, what your question is to your respective professor in a more or less correct way, in a more or less complete way, English and other things will not be a problem. So do not be afraid ki mera English, spoken English, acha nahi hai, I'm not that fluent.
Sorry, Animesh, I'll be interrupting you once. So there is a suggestion on the Facebook Live is you can remove the top bar in the keynote. So
I can remove what?
The top bar.
Top bar.
Yeah.
Matlab ye title.
I mean, whatever is showing in your screen that. Not this one. Like when you go to the presentation mode or like up to. Yeah. So the top bar is.
Top bar
is
right there.
I think it is getting showed. Yeah, that one.
Okay, this one.
Right.
Okay. उसके कारण हो रहा है क्या प्रॉब्लम? अच्छा मैं देखता हूँ इसको मिनिमाइज कैसे करना है, बट आई एम नॉट क्वाइट वेल वर्स्ड विद दिस.
Or else I'll request you to continue, I guess. I mean, if there is problem, you can continue.
Okay, hide floating meeting controls. ठीक है, hide कर दिया. ठीक है.
Okay, yeah.
हाँ ठीक है. हाँ, so मैं कह रहा था कि अगर आप काफी comfortably आपके ideas और आपके questions कैसे भी टूटे फूटे इंग्लिश में अगर आप कन्वे कर पा रहे हो आपके प्रोफेसर से, टूटा फूटा तो इंग्लिश नहीं होगा इतना यहाँ तक आप आए हो तो. सो अगर आप फ्लुएंट भी नहीं हो, आपके स्पोकन इंग्लिश के ऊपर आपका कॉन्फिडेंस अगर नहीं है, तब भी लैंग्वेज विल नॉट बी अ प्रॉब्लम मच. इन साइंस आइडियाज मैटर मोर. एंड लेट मी टेल यू दिस फॉर वंस एंड फॉर ऑल, मैंने यह बहुत स्टूडेंट्स को डीले करते देखा है, प्रोक्रेस्टिनेट करते देखा है अप्लाइंग इवन टू यूरोप, कंसिडरिंग दैट यूरोप में भी टॉफेल लगेगा, जीआरई लगेगा. भाई मैं ये लास्ट बार बता देता हूँ, आप जो यूरोप में अभी पीएचडी कर रहे हैं उनसे भी पूछ के देखो, यूरोप में पीएचडी करने के लिए जीआरई और टॉफेल दोनों में से किसी की भी जरूरत बिल्कुल नहीं है. सो दिस इज वेरी क्लियर एंड वेरी लाउड एंड क्लियर. यू डोंट नीड टू अप्लाई फॉर जी, यू डोंट नीड टू सिट फॉर जीआरई एज वेल एज टॉफेल इफ योर सोल एम इज यूरोप पीएचडी एप्लीकेशन एंड ऑफकोर्स इंडिया एज वेल. अगर आप यूएस में जा रहे हो तो आपको एक इंग्लिश एग्जाम तो कंपल्सरी है, सो यू विल स्ट्रिक्टली हैव टू सिट फॉर टॉफेल और वो जो दूसरी एग्जाम हो यूएस है तो. फॉर यूएस एप्लीकेशंस, ओके, देयर आर टू काइंड्स ऑफ जीआरईस, फर्स्ट इंग्लिश जीआरई एंड देन द सब्जेक्ट स्पेसिफिक जीआरई. फॉर यूएस एप्लीकेशंस इंग्लिश जीआरई इज कॉमनली नॉट रिक्वायर्ड बायोलॉजी में, लेकिन फिजिक्स केमिस्ट्री मैथ्स में इट इज हाईली रिकमेंडेड टू गिव इंग्लिश जीआरई. फॉर यूएस एप्लीकेशंस अगेन नॉट फॉर यूरोप, यूरोप में तो कुछ लगता ही नहीं है टॉफेल जीआरई, लेकिन अगेन फॉर यूएस एप्लीकेशंस सब्जेक्ट जीआरई इज नॉट एट ऑल रिक्वायर्ड इन बायोलॉजी, बट इट इज ऑप्शनल इन केम. अगर आप सब्जेक्ट जीआरई दोगे तो केम में फायदा होगा, केम के एप्लीकेशंस को. और जितना मैंने सुना है फिजिक्स और मैथ्स के एप्लीकेशंस के लिए सब्जेक्ट जीआरई हाईली रिकमेंडेड है. सो इफ यू वांट टू गेट सिलेक्टेड इनटू यूएस यूनिवर्सिटीज एंड इफ यू आर अ फिजिक्स एंड मैथ्स स्टूडेंट यू हैव टू गिव सब्जेक्ट एज वेल एज इंग्लिश जीआरई. दैट्स व्हाट आई हैव हर्ड फ्रॉम माय फ्रेंड्स. ये एक लिंक है, मैं बाद में स्लाइड्स शेयर करूंगा दीप्त तनु से, वो आपको शेयर करेगा. और मेरा जो ग्नोसिका पे मैंने ब्लॉग लिखा था उसमें भी ये लिंक अवेलेबल है. इफ यू कैन गो टू दिस लिंक देन उन्होंने बहुत अच्छे तरीके से फिजिक्स केमिस्ट्री मैथमेटिक्स और बायोलॉजी में कौन कौन से यूनिवर्सिटीज में जीआरई रिक्वायर्ड है, कौन कौन से में ऑप्शनल है और कौन कौन से में नॉट एट ऑल रिक्वायर्ड है, इसका बहुत अच्छे से डॉक्यूमेंटेशन इन्होंने इस वेबसाइट पे किया है इन डिफरेंट एक्सेल शीट्स फॉर बायो फिजिक्स एंड केमिस्ट्री एंड मैथ्स. सो गो टू देम, सी कि आपके फाइनल लिस्ट के यूनिवर्सिटीज में जीआरई लगता है या नहीं लगता. आई डिड नॉट अपियर फॉर एनी ऑफ द जीआरईज, नाइदर सब्जेक्ट नॉर इंग्लिश, बट आई डिड अपियर फॉर टॉफेल. सो एनी जीआरई रिलेटेड गाइडेंस आई मे नॉट बी एबल टू गिव, टॉफेल आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट. सो या आई टोल्ड यू कि साइंस में आइडियाज मैटर मोर एंड लैंग्वेजेस नॉट सो मच, दैट इज एब्सोल्युटली ट्रू. बट धीरे धीरे आपको आपके इंग्लिश का कॉन्फिडेंस बिल्डअप करके लेके जाना है टू अ वेरी हायर लेवल. Because without English, you cannot survive in any stream at a very higher level, be it in job applications, be it in academia, be it in industry, anywhere. If you want to make a good career for yourself in any discipline, you need good English. So, dheere dheere, khud ko alag alag comfort zone ke bahar ke situations mein put up karke, improve your English through experience. So, yeah, TOEFL difficulty, I found it was more like CBSE 10th or 12th English exam level. What I would highly recommend is give mock test. There are mock tests available for TOEFL. I strongly recommend giving mock test. And you need 1 to 2 weeks of practice for TOEFL. मैं बिना practice करके गया था, so I was slightly overconfident कि भाई ठीक है हो जाएगा TOEFL में अपना. लेकिन क्या होता है कि आपका English अच्छा होता है, लेकिन you don't know what kind of questions will be coming. You can't manage time at that moment. You are listening or on your headphones. You are listening some questions, and there is a lot of noise in the room. So ये सब counter करने के लिए to train yourself, some practice is highly recommended. Do not need to buy any of the TOEFL expensive books that are available in the market. Agar paisa gawana hai to buy karo, warna to koi zarurat nahi hai. Jo YouTube pe material hai, just type TOEFL material, TOEFL preparation, that is enough for preparation. 1-2 weeks of practice and preparation. Aur free PDF books to available already hai. Okay, so as maine kaha tha ki maine to practice ki nahi thi. लेकिन प्रैक्टिस करने से योर एक्यूरेसी, टाइम मैनेजमेंट, कंफर्ट लेवल विद द एग्जाम और कॉन्फिडेंस सब इंक्रीज होगा. सो डू प्रैक्टिस, आई हाईली रिकमेंड इट. और अलग अलग यूएस, अगेन यूरोप में तो लगता नहीं है, यूएस में अलग अलग यूनिवर्सिटीज में टॉफेल का अलग अलग कट ऑफ होता है. एंड देर आर फोर सेक्शंस इन टॉफेल, स्पीकिंग, लिसनिंग, रीडिंग एंड राइटिंग. एंड अलग अलग यूनिवर्सिटीज डिक्लेयर देयर डिफरेंट कट ऑफ सेक्शन वाइज. सो स्पीकिंग में इतना चाहिए, रीडिंग में इतना चाहिए, राइटिंग में इतना चाहिए और लिसनिंग में इतना चाहिए. सो वॉट एवर यूनिवर्सिटीज यू आर एमिंग टू अप्लाई टू, बिफोर प्रैक्टिसिंग एंड बिफोर सिटिंग फॉर टॉफेल, सी कि आपके यूनिवर्सिटीज के लिए कट ऑफ क्या है. एंड इट्स इट शुड द एम शुड नॉट बी लाइक आई वॉन्ट टू बी द टॉपर टॉपर इन टॉफेल. जस्ट क्लियर द कट ऑफ, दैट इज इनफ. सो डू नॉट पैनिक, डू नॉट सॉर्ट ऑफ लूज योर माइंड मच ऑन टॉफेल, जस्ट स्ट्रेटेजाइज एंड प्रैक्टिस, दैट विल बी इनफ. टॉफेल एग्जाम फी $180 है. इसमें एक मॉक टेस्ट ऑनलाइन इंक्लूडेड है टॉफेल के वेबसाइट पे, और चार अलग अलग यूएस यूनिवर्सिटीज में आप टॉफेल के स्कोर्स फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट भेज सकते हो इंक्लूडेड विद इन दिस $180 फी. वो चार यूनिवर्सिटीज कॉम्प्लीमेंट्री होने के बाद, और अगर ज्यादा यूनिवर्सिटीज में आपको आपके टॉफेल के स्कोर्स भेजने हैं, देन यू नीड टू पे $20 ईच फॉर एवरी न्यू यूनिवर्सिटी. टॉफेल हैपेंस 2 to 3 times एवरी मंथ. सो आई डोंट नो हाउ इट इज ड्यूरिंग द पैंडेमिक, but in non-pandemic times it used to happen 2 to 3 times every month. So don't panic so much. GRE jo hoti hai, GRE bhi I think once or twice a month hoti hai, English GRE, lekin subject GRE kafi rare hoti hai, kafi occasional hoti hai. I think it is only during September and October. So see ki aapko kaun se exams dene hai, kab available hai, plan in advance. Okay, now talking about application form filling. First of all, start your application form filling early. और मैंने ये नोटिस किया कि जो फॉर्म्स मैंने पहले भरे थे, मतलब December 1 को डेडलाइन थी यूएस की, और जो फॉर्म्स मैंने अक्टूबर या नवंबर में स्टार्ट फिलअप करने स्टार्ट किए थे, दोज एप्लीकेशंस दोज रिजल्ट्स वर मोर पॉजिटिव एज कम्पेयर टू दोज एप्लीकेशंस विच आई फिल्ड अप इन वेरी हेस्ट. सो या स्टार्ट योर एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म फिलिंग अर्ली, एस्पेशली दोज यूनिवर्सिटीज जहाँ पे आपका ज्यादा प्रेफरेंस है, ज्यादा चांस है, वहाँ के एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म तो जल्दी फिलअप करो. पहले पर्सनल डिटेल फिलअप करो and then jump to the reference letter section. क्योंकि अगर जब आप reference letter section fill up करके reference letter submission link भेज दोगे, so your mentors, your professors will have ample time to think about your recommendation and submit your recommendation to the correct link. So personal details होने के बाद jump to reference letter section and fill that first. Each form will have some unique sections. कुछ अलग पूछेंगे कि how do you deal with failure, why do you want to do a PhD, वॉट इफ नॉट पी एच डी, अलग अलग क्वेश्चन, अलग अलग कुछ भी पूछ सकते. सो पहले फॉर्म फिलअप करने से पहले देखो कि हर यूनिवर्सिटी क्या क्या अलग क्वेश्चन पूछी है एंड ट्राई टू थिंक ऑन दोज लाइन्स. ऑल्सो अ लेटेस्ट ट्रांसक्रिप्ट, एकेडमिक ट्रांसक्रिप्ट विल बी रिक्वायर्ड. सो टेक इट इन एडवांस फ्रॉम द एकेडमिक सेल. फोर्थ ईयर सेकेंड सेम होने के बाद, मतलब फिफ्थ ईयर फर्स्ट सेम जब आपका शुरू है, तब टेक एन एकेडमिक ट्रांसक्रिप्ट फ्रॉम आईसर कोलकाता एकेडमिक सेल. एंड या take recommendations from 2 to 3 references or 2 to 3 mentors. Fourth optional hota hai, but don't attach 4, 2 or 3 is enough. Okay, so unhi professor ke paas jao recommendation lene ke liye jinke sath aapka personal 1-to-1 rapport build up hua hai during your undergrad life. Don't go to a random professor first, but again don't also fear. Ye man mein mat rakho ki are mujhe to koi janta hi nahi pure department mein, main to acha student nahi hu. It's not like that. Some professors really know you well. So go and talk and see if the professor knows you well, और उन्हीं से रेको लो जो आपको अच्छे से जानते हो. Explain your requirements in recommendations to the professor. The recommendation should not be generic. So I'll be answering that question here. कि जैसे मैंने chemistry में minor किया, so I also attach in some applications recommendations from professors in chemistry department. So before taking the recommendations, I wrote to them in an email कि I have done a minor in chemistry. So a recommendation from you will add a flavor of interdisciplinarity to my application. So you can slightly try to slip in the prof's mind and say ki aapko recommendation mein kya kya zarurat hai unke side se. Again ye mat likho ki sir aisa likho waisa likho, sir bolenge ki bhai tu hi likh de fir. But yeah, explain your requirements and it should not be very generic. Ki it should not be like ki okay, he's a good student, he's intelligent, he's hardworking. These are very generic things which can be written to hundreds of students. So it should be talking about some experience, ki he did a project in my lab, he took my course, he did a activity under me or something like that. send your CV so that they get some help while they write your recommendations. They can see what your achievements are and they can enlist them in their recommendations. Oh, why is it stuck? Oh, okay. Yeah. And do not write your own recommendation for them. So some professors might say, okay, I'm very busy. You write your own recommendation draft, send it to me. I'll just sign it and submit it. Do not do that. Why? Because I have heard some cases wherein a student was already accepted in a university, and after getting accepted, after 1 or 2 months time, he got a rejection email saying that we have now noticed that you have written one of your recommendations by yourself and this is against our policy, so we cannot continue or we cannot engage with you further. We are sorry, your admission is cancelled. So now they have very advanced softwares in which they can check the editing history details of every document. So do not write your own recommendations for them and give them advance time, like contact them 1 or 2 months in advance so that they do not rush and they give enough time to your recommendation. Why is it? Oh, okay. Yeah. Statement of purpose. Coming to the most important point of the applications. It takes a lot of time, a lot of time. It took me more than 1 or 2 months to write my first SOP. So start early, give it some time. It's like writing a poem. It has to come from within. Read the SOP guidelines mentioned by your university. आप जिस यूनिवर्सिटी में अप्लाई कर रहे हो उस यूनिवर्सिटी के वेबसाइट्स पे जाओ. हर यूनिवर्सिटी के एसओपी गाइडलाइंस लिखे होते हैं. व्हाट डू दे एक्सपेक्ट फ्रॉम एसओपीस दैट दे आर सीकिंग. सो रीड दैट एंड ट्राई टू इनकॉर्पोरेट दोज रिक्वायरमेंट्स. सी स्टैंडर्ड एसओपी एग्जांपल्स ऑन इंटरनेट. सीक हेल्प फ्रॉम योर सीनियर्स. सी रिक्वायर्ड फॉर्मेट ऑफ ईच एसओपी फॉर ईच यूनिवर्सिटी. दैट इज हर यूनिवर्सिटी का कुछ अलग होगा. मैक्सिमम वर्ड लिमिट, पेज काउंट एटसेट्रा. और मेरे ओपिनियन में राइट योर एसओपी इन लेटेक बिकॉज इट लुक्स वेरी प्रोफेशनल एज कम्पेयर टू राइटिंग इट ऑन वर्ड. ऑल्सो यू कैन प्ले विथ मार्जिन्स एंड ऑल. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल किसी यूनिवर्सिटी के एसओपी रिक्वायरमेंट्स में दे हैव मेंशन जस्ट द पेज काउंट एंड नॉट द वर्ड काउंट. देन यू कैन प्ले विद द डायमेंशंस ऑफ द मार्जिन्स, हेडर, फुटर एंड इंक्रीज योर वर्ड काउंट विद इन टू पेजेस. लेटेक गिव्स यू दैट काइंड ऑफ फ्रीडम. Help each other, each of your batchmates in writing SOPs. It will be mutually beneficial. You will learn from each other and the process will be highly enriching. What do I mean by asking your potential professors to review your SOPs? Most of the times you write something incorrectly about that university. You mention abbreviations used for that university or that school. So your potential professor will give you suggestions. Expand on this paragraph. Mention more about your thesis research, mention more about your academic achievements, mention less about your personal story, whatever. So talk to your potential prof. If he has time, try to engage him in your application process. मैंने एक नीचे एक क्या disclaimer डाला है, discretion डाला है कि trade-off between keeping engaged and not spamming or not annoying. So obviously कोई भी prof आपके application के ऊपर जितना time invest करेगा, it will be that harder for him or her to reject you later. So try to establish a good trade-off wherein you are keeping the prof engaged on your application, but you're also not spamming him too much with your SOP and your emails. So yeah, so I have listed some links here. Cornell SOP recommendations that I had sought help from before writing my SOP. Similarly, there are SOP recommendations from a lot of universities. And the prof's tip for drafting apps. This is, I think, one of the most important blogs I have read before applying for my US universities. वो प्रोफ ने ये बोला कि जो भी यूनिवर्सिटी में आप अप्लाई कर रहे हो ना, आपका एप्लीकेशन ज्यादा से ज्यादा 5 से 7 मिनट देखा जाता है. दे जस्ट स्क्रॉल थ्रू योर एप्लीकेशन, दे सी सीवी कैसा है, एसओपी में क्या क्या लिखा है, एंड देन दे मेक अ क्विक डिसीजन. इज द एसओपी एंड इज द एप्लीकेशन इम्पैक्टफुल, इज इट इम्प्रेसिंग. अगर इम्प्रेसिंग है देन दे कीप इट इन अ गुड स्लॉट, इंटरेस्टिंग स्टार्टिंग पैराग्राफ. इन शॉर्ट व्हाट आई हैव रिटन इज व्हाई एम आई अप्लाइंग टू दिस पर्टिकुलर पीएचडी प्रोग्राम. That is what I have summed up in my paragraph 1 in an interesting and a catchy way. Maybe I'll give you like a half minute to read what I have written in para 1. So you can go through it.
I'll ask you to pause for 1 second because I think there has been some problem. I'll just get back to you, okay?
Okay, yeah. What's the update, Dipta Tanu?
Yeah, I can continue.
Okay. Yeah, so I think you have read the para one by now. So yeah, I listed a list of questions that I find interesting in the broad topic of my interest. And then I mentioned why exactly I'm applying to this particular university, to this particular PhD program. Then in para two, I usually sum up how my school years and early undergraduate years have been. I mentioned the information of my first two internships and so on. So this is what I write in para two. In para three, I write the brief description of my thesis project, of my summer internship. When was it? Where did I do it? What exactly did I do? What other academic performances or academic achievements I have? Do I have any publications? That is what I list in para three and four. And your most detailed paragraph should be your paragraph five, where you mention what you are exactly doing with your MS thesis. Now, I assume that most of you might not have been able to do a substantial amount of work due to the pandemic and the lockdown. So just try to focus more on what your ideas are for your thesis. What kind of theoretical work or what kind of computational work are you doing or have you have done for your thesis background or for your thesis sort of background building? Focus more on that and not on the experiments, because everyone knows that it has been a pandemic and it is lockdown everywhere. So yeah, people will be considering. So that is something I write in pretty much detail in my para 5 about my experiments. How did I plan them? What is the future implication of that? What is my exact contribution? What is the future direction in which this project can be taken and so on? And then one more important para that I feel. So first paragraph is very important. Fifth is important and sixth is important. Sixth paragraph for US universities or for any universities should mention at least the name of 2 to 3 profs in whose research you are interested in within that PhD program in that university. So I wrote why exactly I'm interested in these three professors or in these three labs. What exactly do I envision doing during my PhD? Do I have any ideas regarding the labs and projects of any of the three listed professors? And then I also end with why exactly I'm choosing Cornell, or what do I want to do with my future after doing a PhD, and how Cornell will help me, and how will I help Cornell as a good addition to the program. So for example, you can see that in the last line of the para 6, I have mentioned the name of Feynman and Carl Sagan, because those two people were like legendary scientists working at Cornell University in the past. So I just said that I was highly motivated during my childhood to attract the university, attract the admission committee with as many means as you can. So as I said, US applications look at a lot of things. They look at soft aspects of your application. How is your personality? How is your English? How do you write your SOP and so on? So you have to be a very holistic in your application. So some SOP modifications. First SOP takes very much time and it is the most important one. So I wrote, I think, my first SOP for Cornell University, where finally I ended up. So write the first SOP where you exactly want to go, which is your dream university or which is your high preference university. Start with that SOP. Now, once the first SOP has been written, some paragraphs need change. For example, first paragraph or the last paragraph need change, but rest of the paragraphs are same for each university. Your internship interest or your experience, your thesis project information does not change much. So after the first SOP is done, later SOPs come up very quickly. So first SOP takes a lot of time though. Again, some universities have different requirements. For example, I applied to UC Berkeley. UC Berkeley demands separate research statement and separate personal statement. So other universities require one SOP, but what is SOP? In SOP, you write your personal information as well as your research interest and research experience. So UC Berkeley demanded these two in different formats. They demanded research statement separately and personal statement separately. So see what your particular university is demanding and plan early. Again, fulfill specific requirements on the final list of each university. As I said, each university might require you to answer different questions in your SOP. Also include that. Use a positive tone and strong phrases. For example, do not say, I aimed to do this during my thesis, or I like that, I try to do this. Say, like use strong phrases. I am focused on doing this, or I aim to achieve this, or I plan. Okay, so anyway, I think you understand that use strong phrases, and while describing even your failures, use a positive tone. Okay, I could not get this opportunity, but I had a lot of takeaways from it. I learned a lot from that failure as well. So use positive tone and use strong phrases. Again, research on SOPs, read SOPs of different people, research on templates available online, etc. Again, stay within the page limits or the word limits that are mentioned. 2 pages or 1200 to 1500 words is the standard limit in biological applications. Biological sciences applications, I'm not quite sure of other disciplines. Talk to your respective seniors. Yeah. Also, for US applications, I think slight bragging or slight capitalism of selling yourself in a positive or justified way is, I think, required for US applications. Again, Europe applications are very no-nonsense type. They ask you direct questions. What are your research interests? Why are you interested in that? But US applications ask you everything. Again, fee payments. You'll need a credit card. Ask your parents or friends, those who have credit cards. Each application takes $60 to $150. $150 is too much. Average is like $60 or $80. Europe applications are mostly free of cost. I really like Europe applications. In fact, sometimes I introspect and think that Europe applications or Europe PhD programs might have been better for me as well. But anyway, I'm happy what I've got. Okay. You can ask for fee waivers by emailing specific university contact persons. You can specify particular reasons if you really need a genuine fee waiver. And in most of the times, they will give a fee waiver. Complete your form filling, successful RECO submission by referees and fee payment well in advance before deadline. If December 1st is the deadline, don't sit on the night of 30th November to do everything. Complete everything very early by 15th November. I don't know if they take this into consideration, but I think those applicants who complete everything very early are also considered first. I'm not quite sure about it, but again, early bird gets the worm. Okay, so once the application form is submitted, yeah, hooray, most of your task is done. Now something COVID-19 specific, although I do not know what exactly will happen this year and next year, but I think Europe applications will mostly stay unaffected because most of the friends are still getting calls and admissions from European universities and labs. So my best guess is that Europe applications might not be affected much, but US applications might be slightly difficult to apply due to, again, the political situation there, pandemic, unemployment, and so on. Now, again, grants are long-term. So if the prof already has a grant, he will have that grant money for the next 4 or 5 years. So do not worry much about there not being money, but competition may increase for the limited amount of seats due to COVID-19 pandemic. Now, again, as I said, in terms of a thesis, focus on the experimental idea, modeling results, and so on. Try to focus on the soft aspects or your thesis or the idea part of your thesis or how important it is. Why is it a good question to introspect or to research on, or what implications can it have? Focus on that aspect of thesis. Describe how you positively used your time during the pandemic to expand your skills, attend different seminars, increase your skill set, read about different topics, and so on. Describe positively about the pandemic. Now focus for US applications mostly, because Europe mein toh ye kuch lagta nahi hai. Europe mein bas research ke bare mein batao, aur agar achha laga unko toh select ho jaoge. For US applications, focused on your soft skills, soft aspects, like diversity. You come from an Indian background, or you come even in an Indian background, you come from an underprivileged background or an economically weak background. How ICERs have trained you for interdisciplinarity. Focus on soft aspects in your applications for COVID-19 specific applications. That is what I think will help. Talk about what you will bring to the program. What kind of skills, what kind of personality, what kind of addition will you bring to the program or the university? And of course, application committees will be considered. Everyone knows that there has been a pandemic. People haven't been working for the last 5-6 months. So this is the link for Cornell Grad School pandemic disclaimer, where they have specifically mentioned that we will really be considerate during this year's application screening. So yeah, try your best and see where it goes. I think it won't be much of a problem because you already have a good background being from good institutes in India. Try to focus on the points that I think will help. You can also take suggestions from other people. And most of the universities, at least for this year, I don't know if it will continue, but at least for this year as well, this year especially, they have cancelled their GRE requirements. Even physics and mathematics programs have cancelled their GRE requirements. So it's very wonderful. See and go and search what's exactly happening at different universities. So yeah, you have done your job right. And as it is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, yeah, you have done your karma, right? Don't crave much for the fruit. Whatever comes your way, accept it positively and keep trying. That's all that is in your hand. And you can always email me. I hope it hasn't been a very long talk, but I hope that I would have been able to give you at least some positive takeaways. Refrain from asking questions that I have already been covered in the points in this webinar. You can always go back on Facebook and live watch the live screening. There is already a two post blog on Gnosica where you can in detail again read about everything that I have blabbered about. So first read that blog, visit the webinar again to cover your doubts. I'll be happy to read only your first SOP, but give me at least 1 month to do that. Don't say I need it in 2 days. I'll be happy to review your first SOP and give inputs on it. And I may not send my CV or SOP, do it yourself. There are already templates available. Help your batchmates, seek it from seniors. Because again, I have already mentioned a lot in this webinar. So again, giving SOPs and giving everything, spoon feeding everything will be too much. So yeah, do it yourself, you'll get it done. So yeah, best luck. And that's it from my side, peace. Yep, I'll answer questions now. And I'll stop share so that I can see your faces. I hope there has not been any technical glitches from my side. Yeah, Aditya Danu.
Yeah, thank you Animesh for such a nice time and such a nice and enlightening talk. It was pretty informative, I assure you. I'll move on to the questions first, which were asked on the live, and the question that I couldn't take.
Yeah, how about we take questions from the meeting, because these guys have waited for long.
Yeah, I'll move on to them after this. So there is somebody from Niger who has joined the meeting and he was questioning. I'm a third year Niger student and we have theory courses in fourth year, but fifth year has none. But our thesis work starts in the fourth year itself with a partial credit value. How can I apply for master's thesis outside India?
So I'm not quite sure about the laws and rules at Niger Bhubaneswar. If they allow for thesis outside, so thesis work starts from fourth year itself. So many people do like a collaboration thesis in which they do half of their thesis at an ICER or their home institute and do rest of the half part at a foreign university or a foreign institute. So if that is possible, you can go for that. I'm not quite sure about the nitty-gritties and technical or minute details of rules and regulations at NICER Bhubaneswar, but if he can mail me on the email that I have provided with clear questions, then I might be able to help. Or his seniors at NICER might be able to help better than me, actually.
There's another question. Could you explain what is the difference between SOP, letter of motivation, and presentation letter, or any other document they ask? They all seem to be very similar in content. I think this is a very interesting question. Yeah.
So letter of motivation, I think this is some term that I have. Okay, I would not brag about it, but that is something that I have tried to coin because I did not want to confuse the audience in between SOP that I submit in the application form while applying to the university finally and the SOP kind of document that I attach to the first email. So that is what I mean by letter of motivation. Obviously, while writing SOP, your first letter of motivation that you attach to your email while talking to that prof initially, that will help you a lot because you have already covered a lot of your topics. Why are you interested in that topic, that field, etc., are covered in letter of motivation. But again, SOP is much more detailed. Letter of motivation is a subset of SOP. In SOP, along with the topics or points from letter of motivation, you also include your personal details. How has been your childhood? Why exactly are you applying to that PhD program? What kind of questions interest you? And again, in letter of motivation, you do not mention two or three labs. You mention just one lab. But while applying to a US program, while submitting your SOP, if you write name of just one professor, you will sure shot get rejected because they accept students who can fit not in just one lab, but at least two, three labs. Because again, it's not like Europe. You don't go to the one lab directly. You have to rotate. So if there is no position available in one lab, you will end up nowhere in that program. So you have to list two to three professors within that program. It is just about one prof. So these are like the small differences. and personal statement is again personal statement is research statement plus personal statement is equal to SOP. So SOP minus your personal data from it is research statement, and SOP minus your research input or research details from it is personal statement. I hope I have been able to answer this.
So one last question before we move on to Deepthamit's question in the chat box. So somebody was asking, so how to apply for master thesis abroad or outside either Kolkata at least? It was from a junior who is also a part of Team Campus Radio, and so I think you'll take the question.
Okay. So what I think is, again, rules are changing by the day. I do not know what the rules will be like after, say, 1 year or 2 year or next year or this year. Even I don't know what are the rules this year. So talk to your respective department HOD, talk to seniors who have already gone out from your department, and again, try to do your best. Try to apply for a professor outside, because first you need a position somewhere outside. Then go and contact to your respective HOD and see if they are allowing you to go outside, and tell him that, okay, I already have a funding, I already have a position outside. And then go and join that lab or whatever, if they allow, if ISER Kolkata people allow. But I think they're quite open and free in that terms. At least they were for our time. So I hope that they continue to do that. So again, it depends on time specific. It is very time specific, HOD specific. A lot of factors are there in it. So I can't give you like one line answer how to go about it.
So the first question from Deepthamit in the chat box is, can I apply in the next semester, that is spring 2021, in Europe or US? If yes, is it any different than what we have to do for summer, for autumn application?
Yeah, this is a very nice question. So I think I forgot to mention it. Most of the European universities, I don't know if most or many of them, but a substantially good amount of European universities take applications either round the year, twice a year, or thrice a year. Different universities have different protocols. So I knew a lot of people at my Max Planck in Germany, where I did my thesis project, where a lot of people had joined during spring. So yeah, that is already obviously available. That option is available. You can always apply. So if you apply in the spring 2021, you'll be joining the PhD project in August 2021. If you apply during, say, August or October 2021, most probably they'll call you. If their program is not one-time entry, they will call you directly in January, like immediately. That's what I have heard. So different universities have different times to request for applications. It depends on universities. I don't think the application process differs much between spring applications and autumn applications, but yeah, it depends on the university whether they are taking students at that time, and much more so on the lab, because in Europe you're going to a particular lab and not to a particular university. So you need to see when the applications or vacancies open for a particular lab that you're interested in. And in Europe, it is more lab specific. So talk to the professor. Professor might take you even in between the semester if he needs you. So it's quite flexible in Europe and does not depend much on university rules.
I think people in the chat, in the Zoom meet, can ask questions to Animesh directly. So Abhinesh Sanapala, you can unmute yourself and you can ask your question directly to Animesh.
Okay. Bhaiya, so how different should be the format of the personal statement and research statement should be from the SOP?
So again,
Am I audible?
Yeah. I could hear you. Is the question done? Can I answer?
Yeah.
So as I said, personal statement plus research statement gives you the SOP. So what I would suggest is write SOP for the university, which requires just one SOP, one document. Write that one complete SOP document first for some university that you are applying to, and then only some universities. So I applied to 8 universities, and only one university required different personal statement and different research statement. So this personal statement and research statement separate case is quite rare. So if some university in your final list does ask for that, then just take different paragraphs or different ideas from the SOP and split them into two different documents. The personal document should cover your schooling days, your early childhood days, your internships, sorry, not your internships, but everything that is personal to you, your future plans and your hobbies, whatever motivates you to do research and so on. And research statement should cover what are your research interests, what are your research experiences, what research labs are you applying to within that university, why does the research from that university interest you, and so on. So I think I have been able to answer this.
Yeah. Thank you.
Next up is Shoham. You can unmute yourself and ask your question to Animesh directly. Shoham, are you there?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah,
am I audible?
Yeah.
So my thank you, Bhaiya, for this nice talk. And my question is, in case of USA PhD applications, the university selects the students. So what is the strategy of writing SOP there? Because if we become very specific to the area, then the lab choice gets somewhat restricted, but we cannot write something hand-waving also. Mane, there is a trade-off in this case. Mane, what should be the strategy then? Increase the number of lab choices and become area-specific at the same time.
So most of the time, when you select some US university that you want to apply to, most of the times you have selected that because at least there are two or three labs. If there is just one lab, it is wise to not select that university because there will be less material to speak about in the SOP. Your chances of getting in will be difficult. If, say, by some chance that particular lab is not being able to accept you, you'll be trapped. You'll have no other lab to join. So apply to some university, include that university in your final list. Only if there are at least two or three labs that you can work in, you will be happy to join, and so on. So what I did for, say, applying to Cornell is that Cornell has around, say, 5-6 labs that work on the field that I'm interested in, say meiosis. Then I listed 3 labs out of them, saying that my interest and my background has been in meiosis. I would like to take this experience, this expertise, and this interest ahead in so and so way by joining either this lab or that lab or that lab. Now, most of the times, you should write in such a way that any general professor from that subject, say if you are applying in biological sciences, you should write in such a way that any professor under the umbrella of biological sciences should be able to understand the technicalities that you are mentioning in your research statement or in your SOP. Don't make it so specific that only the same professor that you want to join can understand it, because a large academic committee sits who screens your applications. So yeah, as you rightly said, there is a trade-off. Try to list 2 to 3 labs that work on the topic of your interest. It is not required to, say, list 3 different topics and show that you are really a mastermind and you are interested in astrophysics as well, in biology as well, in quantum chemistry as well. That is not required at all. That was just an example, but that is not required at all. You can be topic specific, but make sure you list 2 to 3 labs that will be comfortable about joining them.
Thank you.
Hope that covers
next,
your question.
Yeah, it does, I think. So next up is Siddharth Panda. So would you like to unmute yourself?
Yeah. Hello, Aya. So my question is that, like, just as Soham mentioned, there exists a selection committee. So does mailing professors actually impact our application procedure? Because, like, ultimately the ultimate decision will be taken by the committee, right? So if there is a better application than me, and he or she hasn't mailed, but they want to take them anyway, so they may choose to take him or her. So, like, does it really impact for US, actually for US applications?
देखो कैसा है कि हर चीज probabilistic है. जब तक तुम्हारा acceptance letter नहीं आता, तुम्हें कुछ पता नहीं है. सब guesses पे चल रहा है कि okay, probabilities पे चल रहा है. I have good probability here. The professor has responded well through Skype and email. So the best you can do is increase your probability. This is the first thing. Second thing is research well first. Different universities clearly mention whether you should contact profs before applying through the portal or you should not contact them. For example, I applied to University of Pennsylvania. In its PhD program for biology, it clearly mentioned that applying or writing to professors is highly encouraged before you apply through the portal. So that is a good sign that, okay, writing to a prof, developing a good rapport with him or her will increase your chances of selection. That is something that increases your probability. Again, whenever you talk to a prof on Skype, he or she is also very careful. He does not directly say, okay, I'll take you. You are very nice. You are an excellent student. He says, okay, you are a good student. You apply. I'll try to support your application. If the committee also agrees, we will select you. But again, there is a lot depends on how the competition is that year. If there is some really great candidate who has an amazing CV, an amazing SOP, everything amazing, then obviously you will not be selected and he'll be selected over you. So again, it's a game of probabilities, trade-offs. All you can do is increase your probability the best. As I said, try to engage the professor you are applying to at a trade-off way. Like, don't spam him too much, but also keep him engaged. Like, send him one email, say a month. मतलब ऐसे नहीं कि कि क्या कर रहे हो, क्या हाल चाल है, मंथ में बातचीत नहीं हुई. बट या गिव सम वर्क टू हिम कि मेरा एसओपी देखो, इज इट गुड, व्हाट एल्स शुड आई ऐड, व्हाट डू यू सजेस्ट अबाउट द जीआरई स्कोर शुड बी राइट, शुड आई अप्लाई फॉर जीआरई, शुड आई सिट फॉर जीआरई. सो कीप हिम एंगेज्ड इन अ बैलेंस्ड वे, डोंट स्पैम हिम एंड डोंट लाइक फॉरगेट हिम एज वेल. सो इट्स अ गेम ऑफ प्रोबेबिलिटीज. ऑल यू कैन डू इज इंक्रीज योर प्रोबेबिलिटी एंड ट्राई योर बेस्ट, दैट्स ऑल. एंड इन माई एक्सपीरियंस, एटलीस्ट इफ यू राइट टू प्रोफेसर्स, एटलीस्ट 10 में से 2 जगह तो एटलीस्ट चांस अच्छा बनेगा. मे बी अगर आप काफी अच्छे जगह पे मेल लिख रहे हो, लाइक आई ऑल्सो अप्लाई टू MIT, UC Berkeley एंड अदर गुड प्लेसेस. आई ऑल्सो रोट ईमेल्स देयर, आई स्काइप विद प्रोफेसर्स देयर, दे हैड गुड रैपो विद मी, बट आई डिड नॉट गेट सिलेक्टेड देयर डिस्पाइट ऑफ हैविंग अ गुड स्काइप देयर. सो अगेन, इट इज प्रोबेबिलिस्टिक वेर यू विल गेट सिलेक्टेड, वेर यू विल नॉट. ऑल यू कैन डू इज ट्राई योर बेस्ट एंड बी स्ट्रैटेजिक.
I had another question. So according to you, what plays a major role in selecting a student? Like, is grade point average or research experience, publications, like which one plays a major role?
US में तो मेरे को लगता है कि हर चीज़ देखता है. तुम SOP कैसा लिखते हो, English कैसा use करते हो, तुम्हारे TOEFL scores cut off के ऊपर है कि नहीं, GPA कितना है, what kind of a personality you are during the interviews. हाँ, ये मैंने cover किया नहीं point कि बहुत जगह यूरोप में भी US में भी बाद में ये सब प्रोसेस होने के बाद यहाँ तक तो मैंने कवर किया कि आपने एप्लीकेशन सबमिट कर दिया, अच्छा हुआ. लेकिन उसके बाद फिर से तुम्हें इंटरव्यू में बुलाया जाएगा, इंटरव्यू में तुम्हें क्वेश्चंस पूछे जाएंगे, और वो इंटरव्यू जो एप्लीकेशन के बाद होता है वो काफ़ी ज़्यादा फॉर्मल और सब्जेक्ट स्पेसिफिक होता है. वहाँ पर तुम्हें कुछ भी पूछ सकते हैं. अगर आप मैथ्स या फिजिक्स में हो, बोर्ड पर बुला के बोल सकते हैं डेरिवेशन कराओ, ये क्या याद है कि ये सिंपल डेरिवेशन, सोच सकते हो कैसा आएगा. बायोलॉजी में पूछ सकते हैं कि थिंक ऑफ दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट, कैन यू एनालाइज द रिजल्ट दैट वी आर शोइंग यू, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ कंक्लूजन वुड यू ड्रॉ. सो वो भी एक ट्रिमेंडस स्क्रीनिंग प्रोसीजर है ही. इसके बाद आई हैव जस्ट मेंशन टू यू अबाउट हाउ यू कैन डू योर बेस्ट व्हाइल यू आर अप्लाइंग. उसके बाद तो स्क्रीनिंग इंटरव्यू वगैरह वो तो एकदम रफ टफ होगा ही उसके बाद. सो बहुत सारे फैक्टर्स है उसके ऊपर भी. US में कह सकता हूँ कि ज्यादा फोकस पर्सनैलिटी पे, वॉट यू विल ब्रिंग टू द प्रोग्राम, डाइवर्सिटी, ये सब वो सब देखा जाता है, पर्सनैलिटी, ये सब सॉफ्ट एस्पेक्ट. और यूरोप में काफी ज्यादा रिसर्च स्पेसिफिक होता है कि आप कितने अच्छे स्टूडेंट हो, हाउ इज योर रिसर्च थिंकिंग एंड सो ऑन, हैव यू पब्लिश्ड. पब्लिकेशन इज अ वेरी ट्रेमेंडस बूस्ट. इफ यू हैव एनी पब्लिकेशन, लिस्ट इट इन योर एसओपी एंड सीवी.
थैंक यू भैया, थैंक यू.
सो देयर आर नो मोर क्वेश्चंस इन द चैट बॉक्स, बट आई विल टेक 2 क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम फेसबुक लाइव. मीनवाइल आई विल टेक ओनली 1 or 2 at max questions from the chat box. So while Animesh is explaining the questions from the live, you can type in your questions, because we'll be taking 2 more only from the chat box. So from the Facebook live, there's a question related to, like, they wanted to know what's your opinion on PhD programs in Australia.
Okay. अच्छा, मैंने ये कभी research नहीं किया और ये मुझे बिल्कुल पता नहीं कि Australia में क्या process है. The only university that I know in Australia by name is ANU, Australian National University. और उसका नाम के अलावा मुझे और कुछ पता नहीं वहाँ पर. But I have some friends there who have been selected there, did thesis there, did internships there. So I think you can search on internet. I am not a good person to talk to about that. So yeah, I can't take that question, I think. But yeah, Google is your friend. Your friends are your friend, of course. You can ask them always.
One more question from the live is it recommended to include a transcript while mailing to profs for internships, or just a letter of motivation and CV is better?
अच्छा, तो internship, देखो पहले तो PhD के लिए, internship के लिए, thesis के लिए transcript लगता नहीं है. Transcript सिर्फ एक ही जगह लगता है, पीएचडी एप्लीकेशन फॉर्म में एक जगह होती है जहां पे आपको ट्रांसक्रिप्ट अपलोड करना है, और थीसिस इंटर्नशिप और पीएचडी के फर्स्ट ईमेल में ट्रांसक्रिप्ट जोड़ना बिल्कुल जरूरी नहीं है. इनफैक्ट आई टॉक टू माई प्रोफ एट मैक्स प्लैंक इंस्टीट्यूट व्हाइल आई डिड माई थीसिस देयर. ही सेड दैट ही नेवर लुक्स एट जीपीए. व्हाट ही लुक्स एट इज व्हाट द ईमेल कंसिस्ट ऑफ, व्हाट काइंड ऑफ क्वेश्चंस इज द स्टूडेंट रेजिंग, हैज द स्टूडेंट रेड हिज और हर रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट्स, इज ही एबल टू थिंक इन फ्रंट और अहेड ऑफ द रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट्स एंड रिसर्च पेपर्स दैट द प्रोफ हैज ऑलरेडी पब्लिश्ड. That is what they take into account, because they do not know how your institute is grading you. Your institute might be giving relative grading and everyone might be like 9.8, 10, 10, 10. Then it makes no sense to compare this guy with some institute that does absolute grading and the topper is at 9.1, 9.2. So yeah, GPA doesn't matter much. If your GPA is about 7.5, I won't worry much about applying anywhere, even for thesis, internships or PhD, whatever. Again, what I think is people these days focus more on writing emails and sending applications. But what I think is you should do your homework first. Get a thorough knowledge of the field, read papers, read reviews, stay updated on the topic that you're interested in, network with people and so on. Baki, agar aapka homework pakka hai, toh kahin na kahin toh aapko achhi jagah mil hi jayega. So yeah, to answer the question, transcript is not required and GPA does not matter.
So since there has been no more questions on the chat box, but I'll take one question from Estuti Shukla, who was in the talk. It's from 16MS. So she was asking a very interesting question with which has very much significance currently because of the ongoing pandemic situation. So is it recommended that people should take a gap year, and considering that it will be better, like things will be better next year onward? So what is your opinion on that? Should people take a gap or should they continue?
I think not applying at all, in my opinion, is a bad strategy. You can apply to a couple of places, a handful of places, and if you get in, well and good. If you don't, you can apply next year as well. But I'm not quite an expert in that field. You need to talk to some market analyst who has been studying this topic very well, how the PhD market, research internship or research job market is changing or evolving, and how the pandemic will affect it. If I would have been in your place, I would certainly would have given my best, still would have applied to 8 to 10 places, would not have taken a gap year unless there is some other pressing concern that I need to take my time off, I need to discover myself, what really am I interested in. I would not fear the pandemic and wait for 1 year unless there are other reasons for me to do so. And I'm not an expert on how the market or how this job or research PhD scenario will evolve and how the pandemic will affect it. But as I said, grants are long term, so at least 4 to 5 next year I think there will be enough money in labs, and I see people getting accepted in European universities. Many of my batchmates are getting accepted right now, so I don't worry much if I would be applying to Europe. You would get in somewhere, I'm pretty sure about that. For US, I would focus more on the soft aspects. I would maybe apply to less number of universities because applications take money there, and yeah, I would try my best and would not wait unless there is some another reason compelling me to do so. Yeah.
Okay, so the last question of the day is something that people has been asking me from before this session began, okay? And it's something because you have been in Germany for such a long time. So they wanted to know about the funding options in Germany for various programs, whether it be a short internship program or a MSCS program or any such program where funding is an uncertainty. And I would like to extend this question to you for any option in Europe in general, because Germany has a lot of funding options, but then it's a problem when people get selected or apply in places other than Germany, but in Europe. So what's your opinion on that? So
I know of DAAD. DAAD funds a lot of PhD students who go for their projects in Germany, for PhD projects in Germany. For my thesis internship, I was getting paid like a very minimal amount required to survive in that region, in that city. But it was still comfortable. It was a good time there. But yeah, my prof was paying me from his own fund. So major source is through the professor's fund or the grant fund. If the professor has grant, he or she will readily accept you and give you fund for your sustenance there. You might not be able to travel much and spend exquisitely within that amount. But yeah, I think if the professor is paying you, you'll be well off. You'll be okay there. You can survive.
And that's what I have heard from my other friends as well, who have been in Germany for thesis or for internships. Everyone or most of them were getting paid by their prof through the grant money. I do not know of any other funding institution other than DART who provides money, especially for internships. DART has their own internship program. So if you can apply through the program or apply through the internship program of specific universities, say EMBL internship program or Max Planck internship program, you will most probably get money from the program because you have been competitively selected through the program. But if you are mailing on your own and going on your own, during PhD, you 100% get money. Without money, no one can invite you to a PhD. And if they are inviting, don't go at all. Why? It's not about money. It's about sustenance and worth for the work that you are doing. So yeah, for a PhD, you will definitely get paid anywhere in the world. For internships, I know just of DART and other competitive applications that you have to fill up through that funding portal. And then if you get selected, you can go. But if you're going on your own, or if you have emailed the professor on your own, I think you'll have to search for your own options or ask the prof if the institute or if his grant fund can fund him. That's all I know about it. I don't think I have read much about it, but that's how it goes. I mean, most of the institutes anywhere provide some funding for their interns that they have accepted through some portal. If you're directly applying, then the prof is only your savior, or he can only pay you money, I think. I don't know much on it, actually.
Thank you, Animesh, for a nice talk. I think most of, we have taken all the questions. So good luck for your graduate school and graduate studies ahead. And we would like to host you like anytime in future for any other aspects related to graduate school or something. And hope our audience liked the talk. There were some hiccups in the initial part and in the middle also because some technical issues. However, we are sorry for that and hope you like the talk. Stay tuned for more programs from Campus Radio. And
thank you, thank you, Campus Radio. Thanks to my parents because they have been waiting outside of this room for a large amount of time so that I can talk without distractions. Thanks to them as well. And they have been my real inspirers all the way through. Thanks to my teachers, my referees, everyone, my friends, everyone, because it is a collective process. It's a team game. And yeah, I hope you would have got something by today from this talk. And yeah, best of luck for your applications. Do well.
Yeah, and also you can access the video. You can access the video after this talk ends. It will be saved in Facebook by default. Also, it will be edited and uploaded on our YouTube channel. So you can access the video anytime. Till our next program, we say goodbye from here. Thank you from Campus Radio and have a good night.